the book of Numbers. Book of Numbers, chapter 13, verses 30 through 33. And I'll be reading from the King James Version. The book of Numbers, chapter 13, verses 30 through 33. I'll be reading from the King James. And it reads, "And Caleb stilled it the people before Moses and said, 'Let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it.' But the men that went up with him said, 'We be not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we.' And they brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, 'The land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof. And all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers. And so we were in their sight.'" You may be seated in the presence of God. If you give me a few minutes, I'd like to preach a message titled, Giant Promise. Giant Promise. Now, I got to say that again. Giant Promise. You know, my favorite Disney movie is The Lion King. I love The Lion King. And in one particular part of the movie, Scar is now running the Pride Lands. He has now killed his brother Mufasa, and he's running the Pride Lands. But Simba returns to take his rightful place as king. And he tells Scar, "You need to go ahead and step down." And it's a very transitioning moment. It's a pivotal moment in the movie. Scar says, "That's good and all," he says, "but it's just one problem." He says, "It's just one problem." He points up. He says, "You see them?" And it's 100 hyenas sitting on the cliff. He says, "Do you see them?" He says, "They think I'm king. They think I'm king." Here in the text, God has given the children of Israel the promised land. He's given them the promised land, but there's just one problem. There's giants in the land. There's giants in the land. And I've discovered people want promises, but they don't want giants. People want promises, but they don't want giants. But giants are a reminder. Giants are a reminder that is bigger than you. Giants are a reminder that is bigger than you, that you can't do it in your own strength. If you look at the definition of the word giant, it refers to a human being of great size. But then it also means something unusually large or powerful. Something that's unusually large or powerful. The promises of God are unusually large and they're powerful. The fact that there's giants lets you know that the promise is real. It is proof of the promise. If the promise was not true, if it wasn't real, then there would be no giants. There would be no obstacles. There would be nothing rising up to challenge it. Because the truth is always challenged. The truth is always challenged, and the truth is always challenging us. The Bible says that those who worship must worship in spirit and in truth. God says, if you're going to worship me, you got to worship in spirit and in truth. I need to know that is real. It's the whole reason that he told Abraham to go sacrifice his only son, Isaac. He says, "I know that's your only son." He says, "I know that's the one you love, but I want you to go sacrifice him. I want you to go kill him." Because God put him to the test, because he says, "I need to know if it is real. I need to know if this thing is real." The truth will always challenge you. The Bible says that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb. That's how we overcome. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb in the words of our testimony. We are called to be overcomers. We're called to be overcomers, but we don't never want to overcome nothing. We're called to be overcomers, but we never want to overcome nothing. See, overcome means I came, it came. What is it? It is whatever your giant is. I came, it came. I showed up, it showed up, but I overcame it. The Bible says that we are children of the light. We are children of the light, and darkness cannot overcome it. God will ask you to walk in some dark places. God is always going to ask you to walk in some dark places because light shines best in darkness. Light shines best in darkness. The land, the promised land, is dark. The promised land is dark. Why? Because it's full of giants, and giants cast shadows. The land is dark because it is full of giants, and giants cast shadows, but we cast down. The Bible says that we cast down every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. That is what Caleb is trying to tell him in this text. The Bible says he's trying to steal the people. That means he's trying to quiet the people. He's trying to calm them down, because verse 30 says, and Caleb stilled it the people before Moses. And then he told him, he said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are able to overcome it. God understands the promises of God. 2 Corinthians 2 and 10 says the promises of God are yes and amen. Yes and amen. The word amen means so be it. So it is yes, so be it. So yeah, when I pray, even though there are giants in the land, it's so be it. That's what you have to understand every time you seal your prayer with amen. If God does not answer your prayer, so be it. If he does not do what I want him to do, so be it. I'm still going forth. I'm still walking in his promise. I'm still walking in his presence. So be it, because perfect conditions do not exist. Perfect conditions don't exist. If you're waiting for a perfect condition, you will be waiting until you die. They do not exist. That's why we have to learn to dance in the rain. That's why you have to learn to embrace the storm. Trials and tribulations come to make you strong. We want giant territory, but we don't want giants. We say the prayer of Jabez, enlarge my territory, but we don't want enlarged problems. My boy Biggie said it best. He said, more money, more problems. Do you not know the more that you make? People always want to get paid. I want the money. The more that you make, the more that you have to deal with conflict resolution. What that is big problems. That's big problems. People want positions and promises, but they don't want giants. They want positions. They want promises. They don't want giants, and I'm guilty of this. I want the promise of God, but I don't like the giants that come with it. When I started doing this thing, I don't like those giant texts that I get sometimes after service. I don't like those giant emails that I get. I don't like the giant pressure. I don't like the giant envy. I don't like the giant jealousy. I don't like the giant hate that comes with it. And I'm like, God, no, I didn't sign up for this. I didn't sign up for this. God says, yes, you did. It's a promise. And I'm like, well, God, you can have this thing back. But the promise is not for God. The promise is for me. The promise is for you. And if you lay down the promise, if you lay down the promise, I promise you there is nowhere you can go. The children of Israel want to lay down a promise and try to return to Egypt and go back to the wilderness. But in my mind, did they not remember the Red Sea already closed there up? There's no going back. So you cannot lay down the promise. When Judas betrayed Jesus, the Bible says that he tried to return the money. He recognized what he did. He says, I have sinned. I have shed innocent blood. The Bible says that he shows up and he tries to return the money. And the people said, no, that ain't got nothing to do with us. No, 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 you got that. That has nothing to do with us. He forgot about the promise. He was thinking short term. He was thinking short term because he's like, well, if Jesus is about to die, if Jesus is going to go and I left everything I had to follow this man, then how am I going to live? How am I going to survive? So he thinks short term. I'm going to sell him out for a little bit of money. I'm going to give me a quick fix. I'm going to sell him out for a little bit of money. He's thinking short term instead of long. In the promises of God, they're long. The promises of God alone. All long-term goals have short-term pain. All long-term goals have short-term pain. That's why God had to tell the children of Israel, your enemies that you see today. No, you got to deal with them today. You got to deal with the giants today. But the enemies that you see today, you won't see them. You ain't going to see them no more. Caleb said that we are able. We are able. Able, we are able, we are able. And the truth is, everybody is not able. Everybody is not able. I always say that people, well, I'm not able. You're not able. But through Christ, everyone is capable. That's the difference. Everyone is not able, but through Christ, everyone is capable. The people that he's talking to says, we're not able to go against the people. We're not able to go up against the people. Now, in the verse before that, the Bible says they went up with him, but now they're saying, now we're not able to go up against the people. We can't go. This lets me know that people can go with you and not be for you. No, no, people can go up with you. They can go with you and not be for you. They can be going up with you and pulling you down at the same time. That's why most people are weighed down. That's the story of Jacob and Esau. That's the story of Jacob and Esau going up and pulling you down at the same time. The Bible says that when they birthed she had twins. Their mother had twins. And the Bible says that Esau came out first. He's going up. And then Jacob came up after him, but his hand was on his heel. Going up and pulling them down at the same time. That's why people can like your picture on social media. And the same picture they like, they will screenshot it, send it to somebody else, and be talking about you. They will go against you. The men that went up with them said, "We be not able to go against the people." They said, "We be not able to go up against the people," which lets me know that there's some people can only go to a certain level. Some people in your life can only go to a certain level. And I say this as humbly as possible. Some people, they just not on your level. No, some people are just not on your level. See, we try to take people up with us. We love to take people up with us when their words, the words that they speak, the very words that they speak, the actions that they display, lets you know that they cannot go. But everybody wants to take their family and friends. We love to take the people that we surround ourselves with. We love to take the people that we run with. But this is what I learned. The things of God, they're formed, they're never forced. The things of God, they're formed, they're not first forced. And we try to force people. We try to force people to go somewhere that where they don't want to go. That's why Jesus had to ask the man at the pool of Bethesda, "Hey, do you want to be made whole?" It seems like a crazy question because the man is in this affliction for years, but he still has to ask him, "Do you want to be made whole?" Why? Because everybody who's sick ain't trying to be well. And this is a harsh reality. It's a harsh reality that most people can't stomach, so therefore they throw up and they forfeit. They forfeit the promise of God. Your pattern is what brings the promise to pass. Your pattern is what brings the promise to pass, not your potential. The pattern is your lifestyle. See, your lifestyle is made in the image of Christ. Your pattern in your life should be in the form of a cross, which is up and then it's out. Up and out, but most people are only down and out. Most people are only down and out. It's pattern over potential. See, we're hoping people become this. I hope she become this. I hope they become this. I hope he becomes this. But they're being this. This is who they are. This is their pattern. Sometimes you got to learn the hard way. I had a homeboy in high school. He hustled me the other day. He hustled me 3 years ago. But because I'm going off potential, this is my partner in high school. Mind you, I graduated high school in 2005. Have not seen this dude. 3 years ago, he hit me up randomly on Instagram asking for some money. And it's my boy. This is my partner I used to run with. No problem. I check with my wife. Not really half check because I'm already going to give it to him regardless of what she say. But she says, "Yeah, go ahead." I give him the money, don't hear nothing from him. 3 years later, I'm on Instagram again. Another message come through. And I'm like, "Man, that's my boy. He got to be, maybe he done fell on some hard times." I asked my wife, "Daphne, can we?" She said, "Boy, do what you want to do." I knew she was fed up, but I sent the money anyway. It wasn't a large amount. I went on and sent them the money. I'm thinking, you know, I go to meet some of my friends at a baby shower, and they say the gentleman's name. They're like, "Man, he asked me for so-and-so. He asked me for so-and-so." I'm like, "Man, he asked me for the same amount." And I'm like, "Man, I know my boy didn't do me like that. But he did me like that. He did me like that." Because in my mind, we came up together. We came up together. But the same men that went up with him said, "We be not able to go against the people, for they are stronger than we." We can't attack those people. They are stronger than we are. My question is, how they know that? How they know that they stronger than them? They didn't work out with them. They didn't do no arm wrestling contest. They just looked at them and said, "They are stronger than us." Mind you, this wasn't a nice trip. They went, these spies from the children of Israel, and stayed in the land for 40 days. You over there 40 days, they ain't attacked you yet, but you telling, they are too strong. We're not stronger than them. That's why you can't judge a book by its cover. The Bible says not by might. It's not by power, but by his spirit. You have to remind yourself, when I'm weak, then he is strong. And then they go on, and the Bible says they brought up an evil report of the land. They brought up an evil report of the land. Some things we bring upon ourselves. Some stuff we bring upon ourselves, and then you want people to feel sorry for you. You want people to feel sorry for you, but no, you brought that upon yourself. You chose to spend the rent money. And now you want people to feel sorry for you? The Bible says that they brought up an evil report. See, we find reasons to disqualify ourselves because of our background, where we come from. I'm poor. I don't have this. I don't have that. That's what Gideon did. That's what Gideon did. The Bible says that God told him, hey, look here, I'm going to use you to deliver the children of Israel. I'm to deliver them from the Midianites. The Bible says Gideon started making all kinds of excuses. Well, it's just one problem. My family is the weakest. And then he says, not only is my family the weakest, I'm the weakest in my family. And he makes God prove his promise. The Bible says that the children brought up in evil report, evil upon themselves, bringing bad news to themselves. See, a lot of times with bad situations, bad circumstances and conditions, they're bad because we don't see the promise in it. We can't see the promise in it. We don't see the promised land. All we see is the giants. But whatever you focus on, that's what you're going to see. If you focus on giants, then you're going to see giants. You have to learn how to shift your focus. You have to shift your focus to the promise. Because if you focus on the promise, then you'll automatically start to focus on the promise keeper. My daughter, she's 3, and I can always tell when she starts focusing and locking in. She'll be wearing a tutu, she'll be wearing a shirt, and she'll start looking down at the shirt. And I know the question is coming. And after 5 minutes of studying, she'll say, Daddy, who bought me this? No, Daddy, who bought me this? She'll be reading the book, and then she'll start looking at the book, flipping it, and then she, who bought me this? Because if you focus on the promise, then you start wanting to know about the promise keeper. It's no different than when I look at my wedding ring when temptation comes my way. The wedding ring is really just a reminder of the promise. It's just a reminder of the promise. When I'm tempted, I look down at my, it's just a reminder of the promise. And if I can remember the promise, then I can remember to keep the promise, and I can remember the promise keeper. But some people, they forget the promise. The Bible tells a story about Joseph and the cupbearer, and the cupbearer, he forgot the promise. The Bible says that he had a dream. He went to Joseph to interpret his dream. Joseph told him a dream. He said, when you get out of here, just remember me. Cupbearer got out and forgot all about him. The Bible says that 2 years went by. Joseph was in prison. Whole 2 years went by. And it wasn't until Pharaoh had a dream and he needed to interpret that the cupbearer says, man, I forgot my shortcomings. I forgot about this dude who can interpret dreams, and his name is Joseph. He finally remembered Joseph. He finally remembered the promise. See, you can acknowledge the giant, but that shouldn't be your focus. You acknowledge the giant, but that's not where your focus is. David acknowledged Goliath, but he didn't keep his focus there. He showed up on the field. His focus was to bring his brothers lunch. Goliath started yelling, doing all that talking, so he acknowledged him, but then he shifts his focus back to God. It's the whole reason that Peter started to sink when walking on water. As long as he was focused on God, he was good, but when he shifted his focus to the winds and the waves, the Bible says that he started to sink. But see, sometimes we act like the giants just don't exist. We act like giants don't exist. Even Jesus acknowledged the winds and the waves, and then he spoke to them and told them to obey. But we as people, we try to ignore the giant, hoping that it just go away. We ignore the giant, hoping that it just go away. Just because you act like something exists doesn't mean it don't. Just because you act like something exists don't mean it don't. I'll never forget, Mama, when I was living in Houston. I was working in downtown Houston. I pulled up to a gas station. Go in here, get me a snack before work. They know I love candy. And I'm sitting in my car, and I look through the mirror, and there's this big dude, and I'm not no small dude. No, I'm about 6'2", 6'3", on a good day. But this dude is big and he's small. He got a white beard on. He's about 6'8", and he's looking directly in the car. So I try to act like I didn't see him. I'm looking around. I started taking my time. Started counting change in the ashtray, picking up old receipts, reading them. Then I glance up to see if he's looking, and he is looking directly at me, staring at me. Then he do one of them head, and I was like, what's up? I'm like, oh, God. Now I'm looking. I'm like, man, I don't know this dude. I'm thinking, I'm waiting. I'm like, man, I got to get to work. I'm about to be late. So finally I say, man, forget it. So I'm looking. I'm like, she'll go around the back of the car, but it was blocked off. So I said, I got to go around the front. And he's posted up right in front of the store. So I get out, and I walk past him. And he didn't say nothing. And he waited till I was about to open the door, and he said, what's up, sexy? I'm like, wait a minute. I ain't never been hit on like that. I'm thinking to myself, boy, you too big for that. But I didn't say it. I was just so stunned. I didn't know what to say. I just walked in the store. Didn't know what to say. And I felt, when I'm in there, I felt so defiled. I felt so defiled. And that's what Goliath did. The Bible says that he defiled the armies of God every day. Some of y'all looking at me like, what happened with the story? I'm moving on. Goliath defiled the armies of God every day. And David is there like, man, do y'all not hear this? The Bible says that Goliath had been whooping his brothers and the soldiers for years. And David's like, do y'all not hear this? See, a lot of times we create giants because we don't want to deal with them. We create giants because we don't want to deal with them. I always say, if you leave a small thing unattended, that small thing becomes a very big thing. I always use the analogy of sweeping dirt under a rug. If you sweep enough dirt under a rug, sooner or later that rug is going to lift. And when that rug lifts, people are going to start tripping. The children of Israel were tripping. How do I know they were tripping? Because they go on to say, they said the land, it said it eateth up the inhabitants. What that means is it devours the people who live in the land. But I'm like, how does it devour the people that eat, that live in the land if the giants is there? You've been there 40 days. It ain't ate you up. It ain't ate the giants up. It ain't devoured them. Because, see, people like to become a product of their environment. People love to become a product of their environment. But the thing is, being a product of your environment is really optional. The choice is yours. That's why the Bible says, you know, you're in the world, but you're not of it. You're in the world, but you're not of it. You have to be in the world, but not of it. Where you come from and what you experience, it does explain your behavior. Where you come from and what you've experienced in life, it explains your behavior, but it doesn't excuse it. It explains your behavior, but it doesn't excuse it. You can't go around talking about that's just the way I am. That's just the way I am. That's why God had to tell Moses, I am that I am, because he understood people are always going to use that excuse. That's just the way I am. So he trumps that and says, I am that I am. They go and they start to spread a bad report. They start to spread a bad report. The question has always been, whose report are you going to believe? Whose report are you going to choose to believe? Do not let people talk you out of what God has called you to do. You cannot allow people to talk you out of what God has called you to do. The Bible says that if you have faith the size of a mustard seed. Now, if you have faith just the size of a mustard seed, you can talk to mountains. That means you can talk to giants and say, go from here to there. But we make things bigger than what they really are. We make things bigger than what they really are. See, whatever you feed, that's what's going to grow. Whatever you feed, that's what's going to grow. You feed your spirit, that's what's going to grow. You feed your flesh, that's what's going to grow. Whatever you feed, that's what's going to grow. We create giants. The Bible says, so a man thinketh he is. No, whatever you think, that's what you become. That's why even when I don't feel like, y'all hear me say all the time, I have to think. I know I'm a good husband. No, I think I'm a good father. I think I'm a good leader. I think I'm a good pastor. I think I'm a good coworker. I think I'm a good friend. Whatever you think, that's what you become. The children of Israel say all the people that we saw in the land, the Bible says they are of a great stature. They're great stature. That means they're looking at everyone else but themselves. Everybody we saw is of great stature. That means they're looking at everyone else but themselves. The Bible says, search me, O Lord. Creating me a clean heart. Creating me a clean heart. You have to pray that creating me a clean heart, because we're dirty by nature. We come from dirt. That means we have a dirty heart. And you can't pour from a dirty heart. That's why you have to pray, God, creating me a clean heart. Because once you get that clean heart, you will know that God wants your whole heart. And it's what you know about God. It's not what you know about yourself. You have to remember that it's what you know about God. It's not what you know about yourself. The children of Israel, they forgot what they knew about God, and they started making decisions based on themselves. And as a result, they became fearful. They became fearful, and anytime you become fearful, fear, what it does, it paralyzes you. It stagnates you. So therefore, you don't move, but God is on the move. God is a moving God. God is a moving God. That's why if you read the story of David and Goliath, the Bible says that David ran and he met Goliath. He didn't stand back. No, he went and he met the giant where he was at. Why? Because God is a moving God. He says that you come at me with a spear and a javelin. He said, all I show up is in the name and the presence of the Lord. I come to you in the name of the Lord. That's why generational curses happen. People don't really don't recognize generational curses. Generational curses happen because somebody just backed up the line. They won't move. That's what happens. Because they won't deal with conflict head on, it backs up. So now that I'm born, because my daddy didn't deal with it, I got to deal with it. And if I don't deal with it, my son got to deal with it. If my son don't deal with it, his son got to deal with it. That's what generational curses are, being able to recognize a giant and nobody move forth on the giant. They trying to walk around him and act like the giant don't exist. You see the addiction in your family. You see the divorce rate sky high in your family, but you won't acknowledge the giant and you won't confront the giant head on. So you hide and you try to act like it does not exist. And then when the next generation rises up, they're trying to figure out, how do I defeat this giant who has grown stronger? It's grown stronger. The Bible speaks of, if you don't handle your business, if you don't keep the house clean and filled with the Holy Spirit, the demons, they come back and they come back seven times stronger. Do you know how hard that is? You have to be able to deal with generational curses. I know it's some generational curses my daddy has not dealt with and he will never talk to me about. But I'm dealing with them now. But because I have a brother and because I have a son, I realized that I got to face the giant head on. Mama, you know, Marshall, our sister, my sister, her daughter. I almost got tongue-tied. My sister, your daughter. Recognize the generational curse of women in our family. Every woman done had a baby out of wedlock. Every single one, from generation to generation to generation to generation. And she finally recognized, said, I'm going to be the one to step up and confront this giant and break this generational curse. And she did just that. And I thank God every time I look at my niece, every time I look at her daughter, I think about that she does not have to face that. Because my sister went on and she faced it head on. Break those generational curses so the next person ain't got to break through all those barriers. Life is already tough. Life is already hard. But it's more difficult when it's barriers and generational curses that you have to break through. You got to break through those barriers. Me and Daphne found out an interesting thing. Daphne's my wife. We never really talked about it, but I was telling her, it might have been a month ago, a couple of weeks ago, I said, man, I had this dream when I was 22. I said, when I was 22, I had this dream, and I was trying to confront this woman. I said, it was like I was at this carnival amusement park, this fair. I said, and there was a lot of, you know, lights and music flashing. Then she started describing the scene. I said, how you know that? She said, I had the same dream. I said, well, what the woman looked like? And she started describing her. And the woman was in the crowd. I'll never forget, she had a black hood, and she was like an older woman. Couldn't see her face, and she's just keeping up all this madness. And I'm looking around like, do nobody see this woman? So I went after her, and she's darting through the crowd, and I'm behind her, and finally I catch up to her, and I grab her, and I spin around. But when I spin her around, her eyes, they paralyzed me. And at first, she was scared of me, I could tell, but when I froze up in fear, she began to come towards me. And when she came towards me, I grew smaller, and she grew bigger, and then I woke up. There were giants in the land, the sons of Anak, which come from the giants. And at that moment, I realized in my sight, I am nothing but a grasshopper. And so are we in their sight. But this is what I realized about grasshoppers. Grasshoppers are actually very powerful. Grasshoppers have powerful legs. Most of them have wings. Most of them can fly. Sometimes they choose not to. Sometimes they do. But they have powerful legs that which gives them a boost, which gives them an advantage to fly away from predators. But God has not called you to fly away from enemies. He says, if you put your trust in the Lord, he says, you will find new strength. He says, you will soar like eagles, the wing of eagles. that you will run and not grow weary, you will walk and not faint. That you will not faint. That's the story of the four lepers. The story of the four lepers. The Bible says that it was four lepers outside the city gate. They're outside the city gate because if you have leprosy, that means you are deemed unclean, so you cannot be in the city. But the Bible says that they're outside the city gate and a famine has hit the land. And they make up in their mind, they say to themselves, if we stay here, we're going to die. If we go into the city with the famine, we're going to die. But the Syrians, which is our enemies, they got camp over there. So if we stay here, we're going to die. If we go into the city, we're going to die. They got camp over there. Hey, we might as well go into the camp. Maybe they will have mercy. Maybe they will have grace on us. So they go into the city, just hoping that they get their lives spared, that they won't die. And the Bible says that when they got up and began to march, as they began to walk, God echoed their footsteps. Echoed their footsteps to the point that it sounded like a mighty army. So that the Syrians got their stuff and they ran up out of there. And the four lepers says they went into the camp. They left with gold. They left with silver. And they left with everything that they needed. You got to know that you are backed by a giant God. You are backed by a giant God. God is birthing a giant thing in you. Now, I don't think you heard me. God is birthing a giant thing in you. You're only going to be able to deliver this by a C-section, and that's crisis section. He's birthing a giant thing in you. It's the whole reason that Jesus had to be born in a manger. A lot of people thought, why, if he's a king, why come he wasn't born in a palace? He had to be born in a manger outside because he's too big. He could not be contained. A hospital would not be able to contain him. A house would not be able to contain him. A palace would not be able to contain him. So he has to be born in a manger outside. Because he's too giant to contain. He's too giant to contain, even though he's a baby. He's a baby, but he's too giant to contain. And because he's giant, he's about to be a giant in the faith, because he is the promise, because he is the truth will always be challenged. And King Herod goes and orders for every boy, two and under, to be killed. Two and under. Now, this is a powerful king. What threat would a baby pose to him? But he knows the truth. He knows that he knows that he knows that he knows. So he goes to kill him. He goes looking for him, but he can't touch him. Why? Because Jesus is backed by a giant God. Jesus is backed by a giant God.